Live from Adam Carolla / Dr. Drew's.
This is the first time we've ever done something like this. He's everybody's doctor.
Dr.
Drew.
He's America's doctor.
He's America's doctor.
I appreciate you guys coming out for this. I really do. You were on my pod. Now I'm on yours. This is great.
Yes. And now you, I want to get right into a question. Number one, you watched the debates last night or no?
Yeah.
Right into it.
I heard a rumor, and I want to go into it. You may not be able to talk about
young
it.
Brian.
I know.
Go ahead.
Wow. But I heard that you very accurately said there's something wrong with Hillary Clinton.
What I said was
weeks ago.
Yeah.
What I said was there's something wrong with her health care.
Oh.
I did not say anything wrong with Hillary. I said they've released a record where they describe what her problems were, and there were some very strange treatment choices. And I thought, that's concerning.
Yeah.
That's all I said.
And did you get
destroyed.
You got destroyed.
Yeah.
Not fired, but destroyed.
Destroyed in social media. And I was not. Then I announced that I was stopping my HLN program, just coincidentally on the heels of that. But we had done it. We had decided that months before.
Because the media picked up that Dr. Drew.
The social media. This is how fucked up social media is. Social media picked it up, made the connection.
Yeah.
Then traditional media reported that as though it was factual. The New York Post did an article and called my publicist and she said, there's no truth to that.
It's
I know it looks suspicious, but there's no truth to it. Yeah. No one would believe us that there was no connection.
Wow, because that's why I said to Brian, we were talking about it, like, dude, how about he got fired because of his stupid Clinton comments?
Yeah. and that's why I wanted to get that out of the way.
Because it's all over. It was all over.
And there's no one will believe that it wasn't the case.
Don't you think that, everybody who lives through an era thinks it's the worst it's ever been, but I do feel like civility and I do feel like common sense and even being able to express an opinion in today's world, and maybe it's because so many people have an outlet.
What do you think? Well, the public square has always been a place where bad things has happened.
Yes.
The problem is now the public square is this electronic social media environment like Twitter or Facebook where everybody congregates.
Everybody.
And they act out like a mob. When I wrote the book on narcissism, I got very interested in Aztecs and pre-revolutionary France because those were two times when I saw childhood trauma and narcissism coming up. And I saw that happening here. And I thought, we're going to have mob action
soon. That makes sense.
And
I never thought that.
Here we are.
Narcissism in context of people, essentially a culture that makes it okay to self-celebrate?
No. What I really am seeing is a absolute pandemic of childhood trauma that's causing narcissistic injuries that then is entering an environment, a culture that doesn't put any restraints on that.
And really?
Is that where all the negativity comes from?
Yes.
Because social media, you look at any comments.
It's unbelievable.
It's someone, Kevin Hart, Tim Tebow, you take fantastic people, and you look at the comments on anything, Instagram, YouTube, I'd say 70% are negative.
Yeah. It's terrible.
And on the front cover of Time, it was talking about the negativity of the social media culture. Like,
it's
that's literally what we live in.
Right.
And then they gave examples, and there's a great documentary on Netflix right now. I forget the name, but it's of kids who are getting cyberbullied and they're committing suicide because and to them in their small world, that's all they have. Obviously, Kevin Hart, Tim Tebow, it's not a big deal. They have other things going on.
They don't care less. They don't have the kind of internal resources to be okay.
Correct. When you say childhood trauma, is that what you're talking about? Or?
No, I'm talking about physical abuse, sexual abuse, abandonment, neglect, all the good
but
stuff.
But those have always existed.
But we went through a phase after the 80s, 90s, and the early part of the 2000s where it was just ridiculous.
Why?
I watched it happen. You know, I was talking to the survivors on the radio over those decades. And it seemed to me that, well, first of all, we decided the families weren't important. The family is just one way of doing things. Family's not important.
Right.
So kids could raise themselves. Corolla was a great example of this. He was, you know, sort of just sort of put up
a latchkey kid, sort of.
Turned out good for him.
And then,
he's doing pretty well.
You don't have to spend time with him. He has
19 podcasts.
And then there was persistent endorsement of physical abuse and people having kids that couldn't manage, you know, the emotional stress of having kids and would start physically abusing them. And I'm convinced that on the heels of the 70s, when, anything goes sexually, that's when you saw childhood sexual abuse just going
around. Really?
Yeah. Wow.
When things weren't as taboo anymore.
Not just that taboo, they're sort of endorsed. Like, hey, man, who are you to say?
And drugs
and alcohol
too.
Are big now, and those are highly traumatic for kids to be in families where drug and alcohol.
See, I feel like now people are so hyper careful. You've got helicopter parents, you know, as somebody with two kids. Man, oh man, well, are they those, on everything? You're okay. not allowed
you're
to do anything.
You're in Calabasas, so those
parents, I'm not in
those parents are have had narcissistic injuries, and so they see their children as extensions of themselves.
Uh-huh.
So the kid has to be perfect, can't be other than perfect, and anything that happens to that kid,
yeah.
I can't tolerate it because it mobilizes my pain. So I have to keep them pristine and perfect all the time and never have them any discomfort or misery
that kid
or anything.
Can't grow up well, though.
That does not work.
Yeah, you can't. You got to let them fend for themselves, 100%. Find out, make their own mistakes.
But it's the same thing with, like, because bullying's such an issue in today's society, especially in middle school, high school, because of social media.
But hasn't
media.
It always been, though?
No, because it's different now. Because it's let's say in middle school, little Brown was bullied.
Right.
I would go home, and I might have to deal with it tomorrow. Now, if you bully me, I have to go home, and I'm addicted to my phone, so I see it on social media. But it's a mob mentality because they don't have to have this face-to-face interaction.
And then we don't
They're
know the
all
impact.
Gonna gang up on
That's
you.
Right. And we don't know the impact yet of pornography. And
that's
know,
for sure.
We know it's fun.
But
hey, man, no, I can't give you any. Okay,
Dr. Drew, high-five me.
Average age of exposure is 10.
That's
right. And I have friends at work in sex addiction. They're treating 8-year-olds who are porn addicted.
What?
8-year-olds.
8-year-olds watching porn?
I have heard.
The parents should be fired.
Well, no, because it's very hard to control. I've heard that boys, especially, will tend to, because they're now able to have access at the click of a button, all different varieties of women, usually, you know, pretty perfect with the fake breasts and the lighting and the makeup and
it's
everything.
Porno, yeah.
And so what happens is women, the girls are trying to keep up with that.
Yep.
Not only are they keeping up with that, but there becomes sort of boys are getting more and more bored.
Yep.
So things have to become more and more
arousing
yep. or more extreme.
That's where that Japanese porn comes into
well,
play.
Well, and they go
That's
from
they,
they go from partner
horizons.
To but they go from partner to partner to partner.
Well, they don't ever have relationships.
Yeah.
And then they hit young adulthood and they flip into sort of a love addiction. They go, "Well, I found we would get this call in Loveline." Mm. You know, I really wasn't dating. I was hanging out, which means I was just fine with my porn
yeah.
forever.
Yeah.
And then at 23, I found the one.
Right.
I found her.
Yeah.
And she may not be that into it. So yeah. so she, I became her friend. And I was her friend. And,
I'm in the friend zone.
I'm in the friend, and I've been waxing her car, and I've been taking care of her. We've been a good friend. I'm her best friend. And now at 25, I get the guy calling me going, yeah, the series will happen. I found her, the one. I've been her friend for 2 years, and now it's time. Time for what? Well, I put in my time, man. It's time for her to get down. It's time for the romantic relationship. I put in my 2 years.
That's not how it
works. It
would have happened, my man.
Right?
It would have happened by now.
So crazy. And they've been stalking for 2 years. That's stalking behavior.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. And so that's the kind of stuff we're getting into now. This is a little separate from the narcissistic turn in the mob, but it's an epiphenomenon from the porn.
But also, what's scary to me is you really can't stop cyberbullying. Unless your kid's completely detached, which he can't be, but he's completely detached from social media, the bullying's what I get bullied on there. You
See
know,
the
like,
South Park? That's
I don't pay attention
South
to
Park
it.
South Park has a story evolving right now about this.
Really?
I think the answer, though, is also Dr. Keltner is a social scientist, and he works with Facebook, and he's written a number of books. And actually, he and his colleagues did a really interesting study out of Berkeley, and they found that the kids who have social power in school now are actually the ones that are nice to people and take care of the kids that are not so popular.
Oh, yeah.
The kids, in fact, that and bullying is actually goes across social lines. So the popular kids are bullying the popular kids.
Yeah.
And so it's pretty interesting. But there seems to be in schools this movement, according to him and his research, to sort of be kind to each other, and
that tends to be
something like that going on. I agree with you. I've seen it on college campuses too. And I think some of that microaggression thing too is part of that caretaking.
I worry about that though.
Now you get to face crime and thought crime.
What do you mean, B?
I know.
So microaggressions are you have these police now because as a boy, I have a boy who's aggressive, and the classrooms. Christine Summers wrote a book called The War on Boys, and she talks about how classrooms have become very feminized. And because of lawsuits and things, if you have a boy that hits,
and a parent, you are in,
it's a major problem. They'll bring you and say, we cannot have even a little bit of that. Now, boys are physical, and so the classrooms have become very feminine. Mm-hmm. The classrooms read about, you know, that it's all about non-aggression and using your words and how can you use your hands to be helpful and not hurtful.
There's no dodgeball anymore.
Boys boys are not that way. They're not. Boys are, the reason they play video games, it's an outlet for their aggression.
Yeah.
And you have to let boys and their biology play out. Well, otherwise, you're going to have some problems.
Big discussion. And so then we pathologize the boys that can't comply.
We pathologize. Yeah, we turn into a disease.
Well, and then they go, oh, he has ADD or ADHD.
That's exactly
and then
right.
they give him medication. That's exactly I'm like, right. well, no. When I was a kid, I couldn't sit still because you jacked me up full of sugar. Yeah. And I got to sit and listen to you read freaking Teddy Ruxpin. I want to run outside.
You want to run outside because you're male.
Yeah, I don't have ADD. No, I'm just restless.
Which is where sports, I think sports are really important. At least they're going to be for my son.
But how many cases, especially you look at how many medications are prescribed now with ADD.
Yeah, it's weirdly, it's overdone in some areas and underdone in others. So, yeah, I'm not a huge fan. So. Mm. And it's certainly, I'm not a fan of adult ADD
What can you do, though?
Adult ADD.
All my drug addicts have that.
Yeah.
They found the answer. Psychostimulants.
Really?
They were meth addicts when they were using, but now they've got a prescription to Adderall or something.
Well, talk a little bit about weed. You were talking about weed, and one of the things I found, and I have a lot of good friends that are very real advocates for marijuana. I'm not a big weed smoker.
Yeah.
But
look how different that is. They have an experience with it that's different than yours. That's why they like it. They love it.
They love it.
Yeah. And it doesn't do that much for me. In fact, I'm kind of negative on it.
It makes me out of control.
I don't need it to
function. With Vicodin and OxyContin for me. I had to take it for a surgery. And I was like, oh. Made me feel bad.
Oh, Some people love it.
I love it,
See?
Sir.
Yeah.
Why do you have any?
Hey, man.
Hey, doc, you got any?
But you're right.
You write me a prescription?
It depends on your chemistry, I would imagine.
Your genetics.
But I do think at the end of the day, marijuana is, I'm sure it does help some people for a host of reasons.
Let's talk about why you're saying this.
I'd much rather somebody on pot than OxyContin.
100%. So we're on Dr. Drew's podcast before this, and we had a CT specialist on, and I watched a show called Weedakit where this guy is a fan of weed for CT and says that it helps with the brain. They did a study on mice, and you can listen to Dr. Drew's podcast because mice, it's a bad test pool, and Dr. Drew doesn't think it helps, correct?
Let me clarify real quick. This was the Dr. Drew podcast. I also do the This Life podcast, which is a different one, but please do check out This Life also at Dr.
Gotcha.
Go to drdrew.com for both these podcasts, but the one in particular that Brendan and Brian were on was with a world expert in chronic traumatic encephalopathy, a guy named Chris Nowinski. And he was saying, I was sort of jumping on it a little bit because it didn't make sense to me. He said there's no evidence of that.
You said something that was really interesting to me. You said pot addicts, and there are pot addicts, addicts for everything.
For everything, yeah.
Will justify that addiction in any way they can.
Oh, yeah.
And my thing is, I'm sure weed works for some people. However, it still is.
By the way,
it works
for addicts for a long time.
Is there any benefits to marijuana? Because some people it helps with this, helps with this.
Yeah, yeah.
But is there any factual evidence that marijuana helps with creativity, with muscle, relaxation, with trauma, with inflammation?
CBD. That's when that research finally gets done. The insanity about pot, the really unfair, insane. There's two insane qualities. One is that we haven't done adequate research with it, which is it's been around forever, will have benefits. I mean, it's a prominent system in the brain, the anandamide system, and it will have benefits. There will be uses. There will be something that will fall out of that for sure. The other thing is that physicians should be able to prescribe anything that helps their patients.
Yes.
Yeah. And I mean, if the pot helps their patient,
give them pot.
Yeah.
I don't care what form it helps. Yeah.
I would imagine it's dose. I'd imagine a lot of it has to do with how much you do, but it does alter the brain, and sometimes altering your brain can be beneficial, and other times I'd imagine, certainly for me, it doesn't help.
And let me take my position on legalization. My thing is, I don't make the laws. The people make the laws.
Yeah.
And if they want that, that's what they should have.
Right.
I'll deal with whatever comes as a result. I would choose, like, people ask me, would I legalize drugs, all drugs, and I don't feel strongly against that, except that it really helps me when there's laws that when people lose their freedom, they often find sobriety.
But they do.
Oh yeah, oftentimes.
But
is it fair for some guy that gets his third, pot arrest for having a joint in his pocket to be in prison with a guy that's been I mean, it's just ridiculous.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah. So. I wonder though. So it's interesting to hear about. We have such a. In 2016, we're doing so well as a society. A lot of us have enough to eat. And for the first time, we're living in a lot of democracies. And there's a lot to be sort of thankful for. But it's interesting how there are these sort of insidious diseases we never would have seen, overexposure to porn, things like that.
Sugar addiction.
Sugar addiction.
A big one. Carbohydrate.
Carbohydrate in general.
Diabetes has never been higher, probably.
Yeah. People are fat. What can you do?
How do you feel about blue light and cell phones and what it's supposed to do
to you? My friend Rob Schneider's big on that. I laughed at him.
Really?
And we gave him a lot of crap about it. I'm not unconvinced.
Rob's into that alternative stuff.
He loves that stuff.
Got so mad at me. Rob called me because I had a guy on who was in favor of vaccines and was kind of poo-pooing the alternative health industry. And Paul Offit, he's actually created a lot of children's vaccines, and he runs, I think, University of Philadelphia or Pennsylvania.
So a real scientist.
School for children. He's been around. I wrote a really good book called Do You Believe in Magic? Man, did Rob get mad at me. God, I love Rob, by the way. I love Rob, and he's a good guy.
So is the cell phone stuff all bullshit?
I can't say all bullshit, but most of it's bullshit. But Rob, one of my favorite moments was with Rob Schneider, because his show, Rob, is it Netflix?
Yeah.
I really like his show, and I was watching it, and I'm sitting back going, oh, man, it's so good, it's so funny, but... The hot wife. You overcasted the wife. And at the end, I'm looking. I was like, this woman named Patricia Schneider is the casting agent. She plays the wife. I go, oh my god, that's his wife.
He's the best. He's the best.
Looks like she's overcast.
I love him. I just love Rob.
He's a great guy.
About vaccines, because we have a mutual friend who he's anti-vaccine. I have a 7-month-old, and it's a big issue.
It's not a big issue.
It's 50-50. I have some go, absolutely not. Don't let him touch your child. Right. And I have some saying, you turned out fine.
Take vaccine. Hey,
let me talk to Dr. Drew for a second.
I'm telling you.
No, you don't know shit.
Yeah, I do.
Dr. Drew, go.
Yeah, I do.
Let me just say, there's the two biggest changes in the well-being and health of humanity came with sanitation and vaccine therapy.
Thank you.
Now,
that's a historical fact.
Every vaccine I can get my hands on for myself or my kids, I get them immediately. When that HPV thing came out, I couldn't give it to the boys fast enough. Can bad things happen whenever you interact with the medical system? Yes.
But that's the exception, is what you're saying.
Take a
look at smallpox.
And again, it's risk benefit analysis. Yes. That's always what you're doing. You've never seen somebody die of measles. You will soon. Because
parents aren't doing it.
It's coming.
So you say diphtheria. Get as many vaccines as you can. Load the kids up with vaccines.
Maybe you don't want to do them all at once because the reactions are a little intense sometimes. But I didn't hold back on anything. I would never dream of it.
We have eradicated smallpox.
Really crazy healthy.
There are diseases that were so horrible, from tetanus to smallpox to diphtheria that used to roll through communities in this country and kill countless numbers of children. Polio. Oh, yeah. And anyone who's against vaccines is simply ignorant to the history.
Well, no, you can't say that. Some people have a legit reason. Some people's kids are, they're the exception where their kid had a bad reaction.
They're still ignorant to the fact, and I'm going to get a lot of heat for this, and I can't wait. Please bring it on. If you are anti-vaccine, now I understand if somebody says, I can understand this. Let me clarify. If somebody says, you want my kids to get 64 vaccines, let me think about this.
That's what I'm
and
doing
all,
right now, by
and,
the way.
And yeah. all at once, but wait a minute. How many of these vaccines are actually money makers for some company that is going to make money off these vaccines, because there's a small chance my kid could get it? And I understand a healthy suspicion when it comes to the pharmaceutical industry and saying 64, it used to be 12 vaccines, now 64. I get that.
So how do you decide which ones to do?
So all I'm saying is this. I do think there are some vaccines you should absolutely get, because we know the record. Polio, smallpox, there are certain with diphtheria,
Dr.
measles,
Dr. Drew, which ones would you
mumps.
For sure get? I'd much rather get it from you.
You ever seen somebody die of Haemophilus? Oh, my God.
There you go. Doctors have a very different point of view because they live it and they see it.
I'm trying to hear from the doctor real quick.
I'm just telling you.
Everything that's available, I tell you.
Everything.
In fact, we should all update our measles vaccines, because herd immunity is going to be down,
exactly.
And we're all going to be exposed soon.
Do you know what that means?
We all get shots after this.
Did you get the herd? Explain herd immunity. It's important.
Herd immunity is
explain
is,
more horrible diseases. Yeah, because our listeners are dying to know what horrible diseases
this is important.
We might get.
This is important.
It's a very important issue. You've got to treat the herd, or you'll have outbreaks. Let's just put it that way.
Because some people don't get
it. For sure.
It doesn't take, right? Because some people, the vaccine doesn't take in some people.
Yeah.
And so when you have a lot of people who don't have it, then you're not going to get it. But right. when you have people like in Marina Del Rey and those school systems where some crazy number of
the
people
west side,
were not
the
taking
west
it.
Side of Los Angeles has vaccine rates the same as the southern Sudan. And believe me, southern Sudan would love their vaccines, right. would kill for them.
New age thinking. Yeah. New age thinking.
That's scary.
With no science behind it. Yeah. And listen, you know, people like criticize people like Jenny McCarthy. Jenny McCarthy had two children that were sick, and as a mother, she was doing whatever she could. My issue is that with people who listen to Jenny McCarthy over scientists and the scientific
by the way,
community.
I don't think Jenny intends that you should.
I don't think. No, I think she's pro-vaccine, just not.
She does not intend that. She'll say, I'm not an expert at listening
right.
to Jenny McCarthy.
Right.
I'm just sharing my experience.
Yes.
And, you know,
so. Well, yeah, her child had, because he
both
suffered children.
It's not clear what they have, yeah. really, actually. So.
But I sympathize with any mother like that. I'm not going to criticize that. But.
Me too.
Yeah, touchy subject. Dr. Drew, I couldn't wait to get to you. I know Brian's going to be bored as shit with this, but we talked about Rams with a concussion guy, so I'm just going to dip into this.
No
wait,
more Rams talk,
up.
Dude.
They brought up with the
I
world
get my
expert,
turn now.
World expert in chronic traumatic encephalopathy. They wanted to talk about how Rams can smash their heads together. Brian did.
Brian wanted to know why the Rams are getting concussed.
And Brandon,
the listeners
the
are going, God
and
damn it.
It was really good because we went into woodpeckers now.
Brandon, after the podcast, goes, Rams? Really? Did you have to ask
that's
him
what you
about
brought
fucking
to the table.
Rams?
That's what you brought to the table. But with the teen mom and the 16 and pregnant, I find it amazing because if you started with the original OG teen moms till now, I know you did.
Yeah.
I'm saying as viewers, if you did, you can tell a difference in these kids who basically grew, 16 and pregnant, and then now they're still doing the show, but you can tell a physical difference in like Farrah is their name. Mm-hmm. They're just, I don't know if they go to therapy or what, but this is what I heard. MTV has to cover even their therapy bills as well. Like that's part of the deal.
I don't know their deals, but I will tell you that both MTV and VH1 have always followed my direction for getting people treatment and have never balked at the cost. And I've always told them that they should take a bow for it. They've spent hundreds of thousands of dollars for stuff.
Really?
Yes. And I just said, just you should take a bow, man. You guys have done what's right, always, without not even a blink.
Which is
rare
for networks.
And of course, right. And this is all real treatment.
So explain to me what I'm
missing.
So
by the way, if Janelle or somebody gets treatment, you don't hear about it.
No,
you will not
hear
about it. But trust me,
it's covered.
If things aren't working, it's not because there hasn't. The thing about treatment is it has to come from the patient, right?
Yeah.
Sometimes all that change. And if they aren't doing well, it's not because for lack of trying.
The one that concerns me most, and if you guys aren't into 16 and pregnant, it's going to drive me nuts.
If you're not into 16
Brandon
and pregnant,
clearly
I was going to say.
Hey, you know what I want you to do? I want you to think about Rams and then get back to us.
All right, you guys go.
But with Farrah, she's the one that scares me the most because there seems to be some sort of traumatic thing with her childhood, with her relationship with her mom's terrible.
Yeah.
Her fiance and baby daddy passed away when she was young, so she raised this kid on her own.
Yep.
And then her relationships with her boyfriend
and
fiance
the porn,
is terrible. Then she did porn.
Yeah.
And I've seen it. And she's done porn as well. It's like One Night in Fair or something like that.
No,
I don't know. Might have made that up. I'm not sure.
Yeah,
either way,
title.
She's done porn. But
I hate hearing about that. It's just because I knew these kids and I just like, oh.
You know when they were young.
They get to them.
They get to
them. The vultures find them.
Right. And I think Farrah would describe it that way too. I mean, she
beautiful,
frustrating
beautiful
for me.
Girl.
Yeah, she is, and look, they're all lovely. There's not a one of them is not somebody you wouldn't have affection for. And, you know, people get frustrated with them. You're watching little snippets of their life on reality TV. You know what I mean, still pass judgment on everybody.
Yeah.
It's not scripted.
Well, some
but it may be
exaggerated.
There are cameras rolling, and no, I guarantee you the producers don't push them to do anything. But cameras change things. Yeah, and where was I? I have CTE, I think.
No, you were talking about the porn industry.
Yeah,
how,
and that we and I worked with Farrah a lot, and we people confuse what I do with them. I host a talk show.
You do the wrap up.
I do
a
season after show where I talk to them for many many hours, but we compress it 2 hours of television. Do not confuse that with treatment.
No,
is not treatment. But I have a relationship with them as a result, and some of them call me and ask me for things, and I'm happy to advise them and help them and guide them and stuff. And Farrah was somebody I spent a lot of time with sort of trying to help guide, and I thought she was making progress. And then she makes these terrible choices that are just so frustrating.
Well, she's the only one you will look at and you're like, God, that I don't know. That movie's not going to end well. She's the only one that I'm kind of scared
for. Well, I'll tell you the one thing about her is, though, she's the probably the most professional of all of them. Even though she...
Business-wise?
Yeah.
Business-minded?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. She, although she is always difficult for the producer, she's always very professional.
That's she's a demanding plus,
professional. This is what's happening in...
Do you think the shows help them overall?
It's...
Or has it messed up their lives? Because it's not like they're making tons of money.
Well, it's not, and you know, if you look at the outcomes on 16-year-old pregnant women, it statistically...
Are they not so good?
No.
They don't go on to medical school.
No. These girls had some of those same phenomenon happen, but generally the outcomes have been better.
Is teen pregnancy down?
Yeah.
It is.
And
right?
Because of 16 and pregnant, they say.
You know what?
Is that right?
Yes.
Because people watch that and go, holy God shit, bless I don't want to deal with that.
God bless MTV.
Yes. Listen, when they came to me about that show, I went, oh my God, this is going to work. This is going to have a huge impact. I know it. Because adolescents, when they see other adolescents going through something, that's how they learn. They don't learn from people me in a box.
That's fascinating.
And so now they've got two academic studies that show in communities where there's high levels of viewership of 16 and pregnant, there's low teen pregnancy
rate.
You know, 16 and pregnant is how I convinced my girl that we're going to be just fine when she found out she was pregnant. I went, hold on. She was all freaked out. I went, have you seen 16 and pregnant? Watch all the times. You go, if they can do it, we'll figure it out.
If I were going to pick one person on earth that I expect not to be a 16 and pregnant viewer,
believe me, he watches the trashiest TV expert on it. He likes Atlanta Housewives. I mean, he's incredible. And he's a guy who, this is his macho athlete.
Yes.
And no sports inside and out.
And
is obsessed.
I love it.
And loves rom-coms.
They're my favorite.
Loves them. I mean, he'll watch him come back with a point of view on Friends with Benefits.
<You're stupid. laughs>
Have you guys seen Unreal yet? The TV show Unreal?
No.
Oh, he will.
It's a scripted show, but you'll like it. Unreal.
How painful was it for you moving on now from 16 pregnant? Sorry to the listeners don't watch it. Check it out if you don't.
Yeah.
Check it out. It'll give you confidence.
Listen, I have new respect.
I've got a reunion coming up soon. You want to make a visit?
Bet your ass I want to come there. Yeah, I'll take some pictures, selfies, have them sign some autographs.
Bring my kid. Will you come save me?
I'll be the creep in the corner.
Oh, fair. That's horrible what happened to you.
Come over here. Let me tell you.
I want you to be security for the girls with this guy around.
Dr. Drew just told me, I guess you need to talk to me in my room. It's weird.
First thing I want you to do is call me daddy. Let me tell you something right now.
Let me tell you something. You've had some horrible decisions. I'm here to make everything better.
I'm ready. Let's close the door.
Sorry. Anyway,
sorry. Dr. I love him because he gets married.
He's the best.
He gets disapproving.
Yeah.
He looks at me under
but
his
he
glasses.
Just disappears. whatever. How hard was it for you to stop doing the Love Line? Because that show was going on forever. And there was rumor I heard, you know, obviously Mike's a mutual friend of ours.
Mike Cathaway.
Yeah, and Mike.
And we still do KBC together, so it's good.
Yeah, so at least you guys are still working together. But I remember Mike telling me, I'm not doing Dr. Drew anymore, or I'm not doing Loveline. I'm like, who the hell's going to fill in? Because for a while they're looking for a replacement.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, when I hadn't actually been paid for 2 years.
That's a problem.
And I always thought it was just, look, I just thought it was important that my staff keep their jobs. And I always kind of wanted to be there for the listeners. And I loved answering the questions. But after 2 years of me going, you guys got to figure something out here. I can't keep doing this forever for nothing. And then when Mike left, I was like, well, that's it.
Yeah.
I can't do it.
You guys were providing a service.
They didn't trust they would come up with a solution. It was just by the way, I called the program director. I go, what do you want to do? He goes, let's go down to 1 day a week. And I was like, let's forget
it. I'm out. Yeah, they don't care. Because Loveline, especially growing up, I learned a shitload about sex from Loveline.
It could come back.
Really?
A ton of it. Especially they had a show.
I might come back. I might bring something else back. I've got some idea. You know, who knows what we're going to do?
Just do it on your own and get paid with sponsors.
Adam and I are still doing our thing, right? The Adam and Dr. Drew show.
Yeah.
You know, as you can see that. And I'll do something. I'll figure something out. Because I love talking to
Because there's a gap
viewers.
Now. Yeah, I'm sure you're aware because people love to call and be like, hey, man, I got this weird spot on my dick.
Well, not only that, I get to hear really I was connected to what was going on in real time.
Yeah.
Like that one story I told you about the love-addicted, porn-addicted kids. Mm-hmm. I heard that a bunch of times. I got to see that firsthand as it was evolving.
As an epidemic almost, right?
Well, but I got to see when it emerged. You know, I was right there when it happened. And I like that. So,
And I like you and Mike. Obviously, you and Mike do a show together, but you know, Mike's one of my favorite people on earth, man. So when I found out Loveline was stopping, I was like, that's incredible.
Are you still practicing? Do you practice medicine as well?
I'll go tomorrow morning.
Oh, yeah. How dare you?
He's your doctor.
He's my doctor.
And he is? Well, have you checked him for hernia?
He's America's doctor.
Oh, he's America's doctor.
He's the one who told me I have herpes.
Do you have? I thought I got messed up with a pack of bees.
No, I just send him pictures and he's like, yeah, it's herpes. All right, thanks, doc. Yeah. I'm not your doctor.
That's even
I'm
better.
Your friend. Yeah.
No treatment for CTE, by the way.
I had a weird experience. I didn't tell you this. I was with my buddy's doctor, and I was in Florida, and he was getting pictures on his phone from a patient, and he was talking to her, and he said, honey, I swear you're going to be okay. I swear you're okay.
Yes.
And I said, well, let me see the picture. And he said, well, he covered the face, and he showed me the picture, like a good doctor would. And I said, this is, you know, being the actor, and I said, you know what? It kind of looks a little bit like staph. Mm-hmm. It could be MRSA. Mm-hmm. And he goes, it's not MRSA. And they're eating, and he goes, and I see him, and he goes.
He worries about it. Said,
yeah. MRSA, all of a sudden, he looks at the phone again, and he goes,
it might be MRSA.
It could be MRSA. And he calls her back up and he goes, but go to the hospital. It could be MRSA.
But that's a common trend because now there's those 24/7 doctors where you can FaceTime with an actual doctor. Are you aware of this?
Listen, now.
Is that legit?
That's a little concerned. I'm involved with an organization called Heal, where a doctor will come to your house within an hour, within 2 hours.
That's
and
brilliant.
It's $99 all in.
What?
Yep, all in. And the reason I got involved with it, they're hand selecting every physician. They're all board or double boarded.
Is it an app or is it heal.com?
It's Heal. It's Get Heal website or it's an app, H-E-A-L, Heal.
Damn, I'm
and
getting that.
Zoom,
me
click,
too.
And particularly with kids, it's like some of the, we have pediatricians and stuff.
It's brilliant. That's the best thing I've ever
People
heard.
People should not go to ERs. They should just use this app.
Yes. ERs are terrible. They take forever.
I know you guys are sort of international. It's not in every city yet, but it's on the West. And it's coming.
Oh, we're worldwide.
Hashtag worldwide.
Oh, we're worldwide. Hashtag worldwide.
Number one. I'm glad you brought that
numero,
up.
Numero, who knows?
But that stuff's legit where you're FaceTiming with a doctor and stuff. You encourage that?
That's not fully realized yet. Telemedicine, it's called. And there's advantages to it. Some of it's okay. I can't sign off on the way I can sign off on Heal.
Like there I are, FaceTime there are... with my shrink. Is that cool?
You don't see
it. Is it a therapist?
I'm just kidding.
No.
They do, I think that
mental
there
health
is
hard to do that way, yes.
That's why I would assume that's a terrible idea.
It's not a terrible idea, it's just we don't know how to do it
yet. It's like Mama Cleo, you know, like it's like calling in a Mama Cleo. I'm like, yeah, I got a huge problem. You know, it's like,
but there is a technology now that they're working for the battlefield where a robot goes down there and a surgeon has his hands in gloves.
Oh, yeah.
And can actually, through remote control, operate via robot on a wounded soldier.
Hey, I've got prostate cancer, right? And I had it robotically taken out. It was a robotic, radical prostatectomy.
Damn.
How are you doing, by the way? You feel all right? Excellent. Good, man.
Go to PCF.org if you want anything on prostate cancer. Get your checks.
Really?
You know what? I had a doctor check mine.
Good.
Wasn't aware of it, but I was 30 when he did. Is that normal? 30?
No.
He might have been.
Was he wearing?
He had some, thick fingers.
I was
going to
say, was he wearing cologne? Were you
three thick hot dog fingers?
Were you
gloves,
blindfolded in a bar?
He put three fingers.
Three fingers.
Oh, that's something.
Hot dog.
You sure
fingers.
It was three fingers?
This was in Beverly Hills.
Yeah.
No, you want to. Get your prostate checked.
You
and get
checked.
The blood test at 50, unless you have a first-degree relative. Then
I'm going to be 50 in January.
Get it? Start getting it.
I got to get the colonoscopy and everything else.
Yeah, I'm down to do it with you.
I got to get another colonoscopy coming up here. So.
I need to get my blood pressure checked because you're saying that's a sign.
And cholesterol.
Yeah. I sweat all the time. Is that usually?
His resting heart rate is 37, though.
Low?
Yeah. Whoa. Not now when I was training.
Pretty damn
for
good.
A fight.
Good for you.
Yeah, it's 38.
Yeah, but he's you run. You stay in shape.
Yeah, but I should probably get my blood pressure checked out.
Yeah.
He's right.
Yeah.
Well, we're not going to waste any more of your time with these boring-ass questions. Just kidding.
Okay.
Just kidding.
We're not done yet.
No, not at all.
No way. We'll keep you here for 6 hours.
So we were talking.
Show them that rash on your
on my back.
Hey, man, I got this thing the other day in Costa Rica.
Hey, bad news and good news. And the bad news is it's a rash. Good news is it says TV.
Yeah.
What do you think? We were talking a little bit about the supplements you take.
I take.
As a doctor. Why don't doctors learn more about nutrition? Why don't you guys take nutrition?
Like do you believe in supplements?
Yeah, and there's more of it going on now, but we are so busy trying to make people not die.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
That's really our job. We have a different set of priorities.
But people love to say, well, you know, doctors study disease and I study health, you know, and it's like.
That's fine. Go study health.
Yeah.
But I'm busy. If you crash your car and you're dying, I'm going to bring you back.
Yeah,
supplements aren't good shit.
That's right.
And I believe me, that focus needs to be there.
Right.
The guy that took out my prostate, I don't want him to do anything but take out prostates all day.
You want a mechanic?
I do not want him thinking about supplements. I don't want him thinking about my diet. I went
specific.
To the guy. I said, how many of these you've done? 1,200. What's your complication rate? Zero. to go do this.
That makes sense.
That's so true, though.
People don't understand what physicians do. They don't understand how busy we are trying to
heal the
death,
world. Yeah.
To prevent.
Brian
death.
Wants you to
There's
learn
no
nutrition.
Time. Well, yeah. I have an interest in that. Of course, Catherine and I geek out on that stuff all the time.
Yeah.
And I'm interested in nutrition and fitness personally, you know, but right. I just like that stuff.
He's in shape.
Catherwood and Jason Ellis, a mutual friend of ours.
I just saw Jason yesterday.
Did you? Mm-hmm. He's trained for another fight.
He said you were going to bust his balls about that.
Yes. It's not even that, but I don't bring it up because he goes, oh, what are you going to do? Give me the Joe Rogan talk? I'm like, no, man, you're sparring Shane Carwin, who's a good friend of mine. He's 270
one
pounds.
One arm.
With one arm.
Yeah.
But even with one
arm. He doesn't have one arm. They're going to tie one arm behind his back.
It's just nuts. And I don't bust his balls. I'm just like, what are you going to do? Because he's over it. He's going to do his thing. But I just tell him, you have kids, man. So it's something you should think about. But Jason's Jason.
Jason's fully sober now. Fully sober.
Yes, fully
That's
sober.
That's a giant improvement.
And he's engaged.
Great. He seems great. Got engaged like a couple weeks ago.
Jason seems to me like one of those guys who continues to improve. Like he always holds his feet to the fire.
He's a great example of, I was reading something, there was a criticism of how addiction treatment is so all or nothing, right?
Yeah.
Like you're either ready for sobriety or screw you, you're not. And he was always surprised that I was always very patient with him. I'm like, no, dude, you're engaged in a treatment process. You're contemplated. You're moving forward. You'll get where you need to go. You want to keep smoking pot or drinking or whatever, that's where you are now. Somebody will meet you at where you are now and help you move forward. That you may not be appropriate to be in a living environment with all sober people because you could affect their sobriety.
Right.
That but, you know, so that's kind of an all or nothing thing. But in terms of being rejected for treatment, that's insane. People also expect me to be the don't do it guy. I want everyone to enjoy and do whatever they want to do and have fun. If somebody's having trouble stopping, I'm happy to help.
A lot of us have addictions of some kind.
Sure.
It's pretty human to
Are
have.
Are you addicted to anything, Dr. Drew?
Work.
Yeah. Preach. I hear you.
I'm addicted to being really good. just the dick. Just the dick in the group.
I would say I'm addicted to, if you're going through a list, I'd say my biggest issues are I'm a workaholic and sugar. Yeah. And I'm doing better with sugar.
I don't know, dude. You're pretty good. You don't have any sugar anymore.
But I know I get that sugar thing too. I notice how I really get momentum with carbohydrates, and when I cut them off, I have like a heroin withdrawal. Yeah. I get agitated, irritable, discontent, desperate, all the good stuff.
Yeah, are you upping your fat though? I
do MCT oil stuff. It helps.
Yeah,
it helps.
Good
but
fats.
Like I drink so much coffee. I tried going off coffee. Just someone was like, "Yeah, I tried going off and see how you feel." I feel so much better after 3 days.
Oh really? Good.
Oh, I tried. Oh, I didn't do it for three. I lasted 6 hours. I was on the couch with cold sweats. Made a big old pot of coffee after 6 hours.
I love me my coffee.
Me too.
And I like my red wine.
I do too. I probably twice a week.
Yeah.
There's research with red wine too, but people have longer lives who drink coffee. Like it's actually healthy.
Is out there now. Yeah.
Yes, as long as you don't dump all the dairy and all the bullshit in there, but black coffee like Steve, you're good.
You know a lot. I always am surprised how much you know about nutrition, but it doesn't surprise me because you lived it. So you used your own body as a guinea pig.
Well, nutrition is so complicated. I mean, just how a single molecule gets across the brushboard of the small bowel, then how it's brought back into the system, and then what the body does with it. Just one molecule.
Yeah.
It's so complicated.
My thing is when I hear guys who they're not athletes or maybe, I'm not going to say any names, but they have different podcasts and books. They write these books on nutrition and all this stuff. I've walked the walk. I know what works for me. I'm not saying – and anyone who tells you this is how you should do it is full of shit, and they're selling you something. For me, my diet works for me. I don't follow a strict protocol like all these other guys.
Yeah.
So, like, I had a cheat meal the other day. I'm on this ketogenic diet, so it's all fats and proteins, low carbohydrate. And I find myself, if I don't have a cheat meal at least once a week – that I don't feel that great, and my body just gets used to it.
I'm exactly like you.
And then I have horrible cravings.
Yeah. Do you know Vinny Tortorich? Mm-mm. Oh, you can meet Vinny. Have him on the show.
Oh, yeah?
He is a sort of an expert in that kind of diet.
Yeah, so it works for me, but I wouldn't tell anyone, do this, this, then this. Yeah. This is what works for me. I've done some stuff athletically in my life. I'm pretty successful in entertainment now, and it's worked for me. If you like it, great. Mm-hmm. But do your own thing, because when I post post a cheat meal, just to encourage people, dude, it's all right to cheat. You don't have to beat yourself up about it. I ate this huge pizza, and people you look at the comments, it's just mean shit, man. And it's like, I'm not on your diet. This is my shit.
This really brings up another topic for me, which is pizza. That we've lost the sense of what it means to have and lead a good life.
I was about to say, I'm so glad you brought that up,
because
we're so
involved
in these details.
These ridiculous things about living forever and being perfect. Yes. It's like, if you want to live to 100, hang out around a 92-year-old, 94-year-old for a little while. So you see if you want to spend 6 more years like
God,
that.
You're right.
And number two, and don't give me this bullshit, it's going to be different. It's not going to be much different. Maybe one day. Maybe yeah. one day. Maybe
not in our lifetime.
Maybe we'll get to 110. But, yeah. but we're not going 150. We're not. And believe me, at 130, you will not want to continue on.
So
but,
you're saying live your life.
No, A, live your life. Enjoy your life. Real meaning comes in the interpersonal
experience. It comes from connection. Yeah.
Connection.
How many laughs. And accomplishment's great, but like I sometimes think about it, like the fun that we have just, you know, hanging out, we do our work, it's always a laugh.
We get paid for it.
Then we'll go, you know, I think we owe ourselves a good meal, and we'll go just drink wine and eat a great meal. There's very little, and with friends, there's very little that I enjoy more than that.
That's right.
Sex is great.
But you know what makes me sick, Dr.
You want to live forever restricting?
No.
You know what a pet peeve of mine is? Yeah. Is when I go out to eat, or if wherever I'm at a coffee shop or something like that, and just everyone's on their phone.
Oh, I know.
It will put me in the worst mood. I literally want to go up, grab all their phones, be like, talk to each other.
Yeah.
What the fuck are you guys doing?
Rob Schneider says blue light's going to give you cancer.
You're going to go blind.
But the good life is not just the good life. It's a good life. Mm. You know, how do we lead a meaningful life? And that's what we do for and with other people, and gratitude and giving and all the stuff that makes a difference for other people enhances our what's called eudaimonic happiness. There's hedonic happiness and eudaimonic happiness.
Please explain.
Hedonic happiness is what my heroin patients get when they take their first hit of heroin.
It's very temporary.
They're super happy, but not filling.
Yeah.
Not fulfilling. Eudaimonic happiness, which is a Greek, Aristotle had something called eudaimonia, is something that actually changes our immune function, enhances our sense of well-being.
That's my next tattoo, sir.
Because you know what you're doing, there's a caveat to that. The best way to put it is that I really feel like we have this strange world. We live in this culture that says, this is what I need, this is what's best for me. I think happiness can be found, and maybe is often found, in the idea of putting yourself maybe last in that equation.
Yeah.
Not putting yourself, not making yourself so important, certainly not making your appetites and sensations the focal point, but rather other people and their happiness.
There's all this research that shows if you are given a sum of money and you buy something for yourself, it does far less for your mood and well-being going forward than if you buy something for somebody.
Oh, that's so true. Yeah. It's so true. Yeah. One thing, and it's a big issue in my house, and really in general, even with my friends, if we go to dinner, I'll go, guys, put your phones away. It drives me nuts. Yeah. But phone addiction is real, even for me.
Yeah.
The stimulus of when I see likes and comments and all that stuff is real.
Oh, yeah.
And I know so when I get home at 6 o'clock, unless we have some crazy something.
You put your phone away.
I put my phone away. It's like, because you don't hear from
me. No.
I put it away. I put it on silent so I can't hear it. Because if I hear that cling, then it's like Pavlov's dog. I'm like, oh, and I run upstairs and get it. But that cell phone addiction's real, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's called process addiction, and it's changing it.
So our video games, my kids, that iPad,
what can
is
you
crack.
Do, though? What can you do? What can you? So if you have a kid, he's going to, you know,
I know,
all his friends are going to have cell phones.
Make it work for you, probably. Make it a learning tool. Well, we'll figure it out. Human beings, what's so great about all these problems is that human beings will never be short on problems, but we tend to adapt. We tend to figure it out. We tend to be moving forward.
When the novel came around, people thought that was going to destroy humanity.
That's right.
Arabic numbers. When Leonardo of Pisa brought Arabic numbers to the West, they thought we're going to lose our sense of distances because everything was sort of a intuition of relative amounts and distances.
Yeah.
Now you're putting this number on it that's a symbol that's going to lose our sense. And we did. It changed our sense of distances and measurements.
Innovation is a form of destruction.
Yes.
Innovation is always destroying what was old, and sometimes that was very beautiful.
Well, I remember,
in with the new.
I remember my dad because, you know, well, I'm 33, so the Nintendo is the big thing. We'd have a Nintendo. My dad'd say, if you want an hour of playing Nintendo, for every hour, you have 2 hours outside. So you spend 4 hours outside, and then you can play your game for 2 hours. Mm. Granted, we didn't play 2 hours in a row, but it'd be 1 hour that day, 1 hour the next day, but that's how he did it.
I think the good thing about social media, and I think the good thing about the internet, is it's making it easier for people to imagine what it's like to be someone else. And it goes back to this teen pregnancy thing.
I hope you're right.
I think the trend, we were always going to have setbacks, but I think the trend, for example, when these adolescents see that these teen moms, it's not working out for them so well, they empathize. You're putting a human face on it. You're smelling it. You're seeing
it
in real time.
Source.
Yeah.
Relatable source.
And I think that even when you see a child crying in Syria because his brother was killed, you cannot help but to think, you know, well, they're not Syrians.
Yeah.
I know kids who look just like that. And that's the power. I hope. I'm an optimist about that.
I hope you're right.
Yeah. We are becoming. Look, Steven Pinker in The Better Angels of Our Nature, who's an evolutionary biologist out of Harvard, a seminal thinker, it basically proved his theme was that fewer people since 2000 have died of violence by far than in the 20th century and any century before that. Yep. So we are becoming maybe a little more enlightened. We are being nudged closer together, and we are getting a better sense of what it's like to be
human. When you see those random shootings like in Washington, Baltimore, Chicago, what's a lot of it's mental health issue, right?
Yes.
The first thing I think of is probably a mental health
Me
thing.
Me too. The HLM television program I did for the last 5 years.
Yeah, we're doctors.
That's
we agree.
but that's mostly what we talked about was our mental health systems are breaking down. Law enforcement ending up being the mental health delivery system of the last resort, and it's a mess.
And we're warehousing crazy people.
Well, do you know the biggest mental health basic complexes? Do you know
jail.
What's that? But what jail?
I don't know, I know.
Los Angeles. Los Angeles County is the number one for most clinically diagnosed mental health patients.
I believe it.
And they have a whole unit. I just saw this with Lisa Ling went into the jail.
Oh, I saw the preview for that.
She's brilliant. Yeah. Yeah. It's good. It's good. People are crazy in that.
So I went to, when I was in Miami-Dade County Jail.
Not a doctor.
I went to
Doctors
Miami.
Don't talk like that.
I went to Miami-Dade County and I was going to write a TV show. It was supposed to be a comedy. And I went down there and I had a tour and I spent a week down at that jail. And by the way, the jail, I think 2 years before or a year before had been Amnesty International came down there and sued the jail for human rights violations.
If only you'd gone to a women's jail, you could have written Orange is the New Black. Right?
Oh, man, exactly. But I'm not that good a writer. The day I was there, I saw a guy I saw the aftermath of a guy who was stabbed 12 times. By the way, he was just fine. He was screaming, trying to get at the guy, and they were holding him down.
Wow.
It was very, very traumatic. But I went into the psych ward. And that's where and Peter Early, who I think wrote a number of books, but his son is crazy, and he wrote a book called Crazy. Mm. And in Florida and in these jails, we house our crazy people on the street, and they end up in jail. Mm-hmm. And I went into that psych ward, and I saw that, and I wasn't ready for it. And I was around guards who were macho guys. It was very interesting because the guards saw. I started to panic because I saw these guys in aquariums. They put them in. You're crazy, right? They put you in a nylon smock. You're wearing a nylon smock.
Yes, they can't hang.
Okay. Yep. And you have a steel bed. It's just steel. No pillow. No nothing. Steel.
It's jail.
And you're in there, but you're crazy. These are crazy.
I know.
People.
But did you think it was gonna be all comfy?
Well, but even the jail cells have sheets and stuff. But these for your crazy, they have them there, and they were just standing there. I got so upset. And I'm not that an emotional guy. You know this.
Yeah,
I was trying not to cry. The guy goes, get him out of here. He saw me. He goes, you got to get him out of here. You can't just bring him in here and not prepare him for what he's about to see. You got to get him out of here. And they got me out of there. I broke out into psoriasis. My legs were covered in psoriasis.
Wow.
And I said to the doctor, I said, I don't know. She said, did you go through anything traumatic? I said, I did. I did.
Dr.
I
got, Drew, what do you crazy. Do for all that? Like, as far as mental health, it's like CTE. Yeah. It's such a huge hurdle to tackle.
Yeah.
It's just such
a diagnosis.
It's just a beast.
It feels like one of the big hurdles, or the two big hurdles, is empowering physicians to do what they need to do, which is, I understand, a slippery slope. I mean, if you empower physicians to require people to take medications and house people against their will and stuff, that's a huge responsibility.
It's unconstitutional. It was found that way.
That's why we have this problem.
Yeah.
Right? And so there's that. And then the other thing is really acknowledging that people with mental health need to be in a structured environment. People that don't have mental health issues don't understand the importance of that. I was talking to a guy on KBC the other day he called and he goes, you know, I was homeless on the street, and now I'm driving trucks, I'm doing fine. I know exactly what we should be doing for homeless people. I go, what does it look like? He goes, this is what I had, and this is what the homeless population needs. We need a place, like like a room and board, just like a place with walls where they go, and there needs to be doctors and nurses and vocational rehabilitation specialists.
A hospital.
Yeah, it should be a hospital.
Take us to the hospital.
Yeah, so we're back to the hospital model, which is maybe we could make it more palatable or whatever, but he's right. That's
it's what we did, right?
It's what we overdid, season three of American Horror Story.
Yeah, so during the Reagan era, there was a...
Reagan era. It's Carter.
Was it Carter?
Yeah.
Well, the Supreme Court said... The state cannot house somebody against their will if they're not a danger to society.
God, if they're mentally ill.
Right, but family...
There was because medications were thought to be so effective then, and these people will be great, and who the hell are we? And you're really doing them a huge... Look at the homeless population.
Yeah. I've never really understood any of that. You know, I feel like I'm a pretty normal guy in my family. There's really no complications there, you know, whatever. But I dated a girl many years ago who was bipolar, manic depressive. Uh-huh. And I've never experienced anything like it. I was literally like, what's wrong with you? How can I help you? Like, you're not happy when we go on vacation. You're not happy when this happens. You just had a huge event that, you know, you did great at. You weren't happy there. There's literally nothing you can do. It's literally a sickness. Mm-hmm. It's literally a sickness.
Yeah, it's a
and then I would just, and then I'd wake up in the morning and go, are you a sad panda? That was our code word. Like, you know, like today, are you a sad panda? She's like, yeah. Uh-huh. And your whole day's shot.
Ooh.
There's literally nothing you could do. Mm-hmm. And then she took medication. She was basically just like a zombie. Yeah. Like, there's no emotion. Like, wow. She's very just like,
uh-oh.
Yeah.
Maybe that's where weed helps people, depending.
Hey,
I don't know.
I don't, the idea of there being good substances and bad substances is flawed. There's chemicals and the human relationship with them. That's it.
That makes sense.
That's interesting. If you have pancreatic cancer, OxyContin, really good.
Yeah.
It eliminates suffering.
Yeah.
If you are an opiate addict, OxyContin, not good. Going to kill you. So it's not about the OxyContin. It's about the proclivities of the genetics of the substrate, and our particular relationship with it. There are way better things than others.
Right.
I'd much rather somebody be on pot than an opiate if they're an addict. Much rather.
As a doctor, how much do you keep up with the new science? It's got to be difficult.
Constant, yeah.
Yeah, but there's new journals, new...
Read. I do a yearly testing, these clinical tests.
Pharmaceutical companies come to you...
Never.
They don't.
They're not allowed to get anywhere near doctors anymore.
They're not.
Really?
No, they can't give us a pencil.
Interesting.
And when they give us samples, they have to send it by mail.
Hello.
So how do they sell the pharmaceutical?
They don't. That's all done.
When?
Yeah. As long as I can remember, a decade or something.
Wait a minute. I thought they had. Wait a minute.
There's
hold
pharmaceutical reps and hot sales girls who are like Dr. Joe. No.
I just read an article about it in New York Times.
Well, maybe.
Well, New York Times full of shit.
Were they what used to happen?
They would come. They hired former cheerleaders.
Yeah, they used to.
They don't do that anymore.
No, you can't. You can't even. Anybody that even lets them in their office is suspect.
Really?
Wow.
Because they're afraid they're going to get talked into buying.
Not talked into buying. No one talks us into anything. That whole idea is so bizarre.
But, yeah.
But just we don't want to even be look at the possibility of impropriety.
So when there's a new drug on the market,
you read about it in literature,
and you say, "Try this."
Well, you'll learn about it long before it.
And then
comes
you
to the market,
and then you decide whether it's going to be good for your patients or not.
Yeah,
Humira is pretty amazing, right?
Yes, amazing.
I mean, that's amazing. That Humira cures.
So
although there was some study that came out just today that showed that Humira is good for rheumatoid arthritis.
Oh also, no, I was asked
for Crohn's.
No, oh, okay, I didn't know. No, I was thinking about.
That sounds important.
What? That's very important. But what cures Hep C?
Oh, there's a number of different companies, antiviral medicines.
Incredible.
They're great.
We've come up with a cure for Hep C, which is amazing.
Except it costs like $100,000 per therapy.
Yeah.
And it's sort of...
But it's curative. I mean,
they justify it by saying, well, you're saving the $800,000 you'd have to pay in a liver transplant.
Yeah. My cousin died of it.
It's terrible.
He died of it when he was 50.
In some original research 30 years ago.
Damn. Wow. Yeah. Basically now, if you get HIV, you're all good, right?
Yeah, you're going to have a chronic illness. Yeah.
But you're good through medication?
Like for the most part, I mean, it's a dangerous illness.
But the virus has had to compromise itself so often. I hear from the cocktails and stuff that now it's not the same virus it used to be. Mm-hmm. And so when you get something like HIV, sometimes you can actually have it in such a weakened or compromised form that you can take, you know, two pills a day for your life and be totally fine.
Joe? Well, I wouldn't rely on that, but... But in other words, I wouldn't count on that.
I'm a viral doctor.
But there are the viruses.
You listen to the TED Talk.
But back to the Crohn's disease, there was a study that came out just recently that shows that there's two bacteria and maybe a candida species, that the three together may be causing some of the reaction associated with Crohn's.
Really?
So we come up with some novel treatments for that now.
Damn.
Yeah.
What about lupus?
What about it?
I have a friend who has it. And I'm
female.
Yeah, she has Crohn's and lupus.
Ugh.
I know. And it's really, really bad for her.
It's bad.
And
I have a friend who's losing his hair. Do you have anything that...
His name is Brian Callen.
Yeah.
I take
Propecia. We need him to look younger.
Propecia works, yeah.
We have
yeah.
a TV show coming out. We need him to look younger.
Propecia is good for your prostate, right?
Yeah. Well, it's a little bit. Not bad for it, that's for sure. And it could be good.
Doesn't it help with depression, though, too?
Propecia?
No.
It gives you depression.
No. Yes, it can.
What?
And it also can cause permanent problems.
Educate his ass.
I had to call some of my Propecia patients because there was some data out that suggests that, you know, it can affect sexual functioning kind of permanently.
My dick could carve a diamond.
Even after you come off it.
Yes.
And so I had to tell everybody.
My dick cuts right through that.
It also makes your nose grow.
What?
Look at your nose.
Let me know, sir.
Do you, knowing all you know about CTE, the addictions of painkillers and stuff like that, are you a football fan or a sports fan?
Yeah.
So you're a huge football fan?
Not huge, but I played football in high school. My kids play football in high school. You know,
Do you look at it different? Because, you know, I played football. I don't look at football like I look at the UFC now. I think because of the UFC, I'm a little jaded because I was in it, obviously, well, not longer, but professionally longer in the UFC, and I know how much those guys are getting paid, and I know the complications that they deal with as far as managers, training camp, injuries, brain trauma. So there's a lot more to lose for those guys. So now when I watch the UFC, I look at it different. I just look at everything different now. Do you, knowing what you know about all this stuff, look at sports different to you?
But I kind of, again, this is back to choices in life and leading a good life. And, you know, it just.
There's going to be risk.
There's going to be risk. Yeah.
And maybe you die at 75, but if it's a good 75 years.
Better than a shitty 100.
Yeah, I'm not saying live hard, die young. I'm saying that.
Immortality has always been what human beings are after. Yeah. It's everything. It's why we love our kids, et cetera, mm-hmm. according to the.
Because I think it's funny because CTE and concussion, we spoke to a doctor earlier on your podcast, but. The movie with Will Smith and even the NFL went, the NFL's pretty dangerous, but the numbers have never been higher. America's like, we don't care.
I love
that's
Americans.
What they do.
I love Americans.
I know it's
go Cowboys.
That's a denial. Yeah.
Look at MMA. I love it. I mean, I'm not gonna not watch MMA, and it's an incredible.
Nah,
sport.
You can't say that. But you've met how many, and you look at it different.
You're
you
right.
can't say that.
You're
don't
right.
act tough in front of Dr. Drew.
No. I mean, I love the sport, but you're right. As you get close to something.
I get
you're
scared
right.
for people.
You
too. I feel anxiety.
You know,
you
hit the nail on the head. Yeah. I get scared for guys. You know, I retired from the UFC, and I was doing this thing for Bellator, and I haven't been to a live event since my fight. It's a couple months ago. Bellator flies me up to San Jose. I'm with Scott Coker and everyone. And I thought, God, I haven't been in a locker room around the cage in forever. I wonder if I'll get the itch to fight again because, you know, I could easily fight again through wherever organization I want to.
Why don't you fight Ellis?
Right? Yeah.
Jason wouldn't last too long with Brennan Chubb.
Well, so. I would never fight him. Anyways, but so I go to the back of the locker room and I found myself, I was very, I kind of shut down. I had an anxiety and I wanted to tell the guys, like, don't go out there, man.
Yeah.
Like, it's not worth it, bro. Yeah.
You felt anxiety.
I felt anxiety. And I shut down. I literally wanted to be like, why are you guys doing this? What are you doing, man? Mm. What are you doing? And they're like, I'd love to come in your show. I'm like, start your own show. Go out there, man. Go do your own show. Yeah. Mm. That's what I feel these days.
I wouldn't want to live in a world without boxing and MMA and football. That's the crazy thing. And I think a lot of us just, there's a lot of value to it, isn't there, at the same time? There's a price you
100%.
Pay with a lot of, but a lot of value.
If you really take that to its, that logic to its extreme, you would never join the military.
That's right.
Right?
There's so many things like that.
Yeah.
You know? Glory.
Never get in a car.
Glory.
Never.
Look at glory comes with risk. What would glory? The glory wouldn't exist, in fact, without the risk of death. Mm-hmm. Our heroes have all faced, if not death, at least ruin. Mm-hmm. You know, so
I think this is easy to say until you're affected by it. So when your son at whatever 14 goes, Dad, I'm gonna start fighting professionally.
I agree.
You're gonna have a different opinion.
Well, I won't have a different opinion in the macroscope, but I agree. If it's personal, you're right. I mean, and you know, by the way, when I watch football, the more I learn about it, when I watch knockouts, I used to like watching knockouts on YouTube, right? For like best knockouts. I don't like watching it anymore. You know why? Because now I see brain trauma, young men getting brain trauma. I used to just think, oh, great, the guy was punching, hit him really well. Now I'm looking at the guy taking the blow, and this is because I'm a parent, this is because I'm older, this is because I'm thinking about longevity for these young men or young women.
You're so knowledgeable on the sport.
Exactly. Man. And so it does change. As you become more educated, it's impossible not to become a little bit more of a pussy about this stuff. I mean, to be comedic.
Shit, I watch 16 and Pregnant. I don't even watch fights anymore. Watch 16 and Pregnant and Dr. Drew, HLN.
Exactly.
I love it, man.
Exactly.
Well, Dr. Drew, we can't thank you enough, man.
You're the best, man.
What happened to him, man?
Right? So, but you.
What'd you do to him, Brian?
Nothing. Right? I feminized him.
I'm like Caitlyn
if
Jenner.
If Brendan came out and said in 5 years and just went,
become a woman?
I'm gay. And also, and by the way, I want to be a woman.
Not
I'd be
gay.
Like,
no
so
one
would
still
bat
be
an
with
eye.
Women and become a woman.
Yeah, right.
This is true.
That. That'd be no one would bat an eye?
Well, both. I'd just be like, you know what? I knew it.
Dr. Drew, you guys are doing live podcasts now too, right?
I'm doing
you
some
and Mike?
With, yeah, I've done some with Mike on the Dr. Drew podcast. I've done some with Adam on the Adam Carolla show. And I just like doing this. It's fun. I like, listen, it's, I think we live in a world right now where people, there's so much craziness going on. I think we almost are obliged to go out there and find out what's going on, like touch people and be with them and you know, see what they're really thinking. Because I don't think social media gives you any real sense of what's going on
true.
Out there, except concern. Like right. something's right. not
yeah,
right.
Yeah. Something.
So to find out really what's going on, you got to go out and be with people.
Can I ask you in closing one question about the human genome and if it's
okay,
worth
see if
getting?
I can answer it.
If it's worth getting a
is
test.
Is this some shit you've learned off TED Talk?
No. But you know you can get your genome done and
I did.
You can get your.
I did.
Yeah. What do you learn from that
not
at
much.
This stage? Not much.
Not
I didn't
much.
Think
I,
so.
There are certain genetic tests.
For Alzheimer's and things?
Not even that so much yet. But there are certain things that you can get tested for. It gets a little bit expensive. And if you have like colon cancer in your family or breast cancer, ovarian cancer, that kind of thing, there are genetic tests worth getting.
Okay.
But it's not, you're not getting it from Ancestry or 23andMe.
What about the Ancestry? Can I tell if I'm actually Italian or?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I can.
For the most, I mean, not with great specificity, but you get some interesting information.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What did you find out?
My wife had some interesting stuff. She found out that she was 75% Czech, and she always heard that her family came from the original settlers, you know, in Czechoslovakia. And
wow.
It looks
wow.
like that's true. I had a crazy mix of Northern Europeans that I didn't know about,
huh.
which is interesting.
Did you just use a website? You sent
I did 23andMe, yeah.
Yeah.
What's it called?
23andMe. That's what I used.
I found out I was mostly Italian and 15% gay. How weird is that?
Wow, that's a
yeah,
great test.
It sure is.
All right, man. On that note, we're going to get out of here. Dr. Drew, where can they, obviously they can
myself.
Find you everywhere.
Yeah, go to drdrew.com. That's where I want people to go. All our webs, our podcasts.
Just Google Dr. Drew.
Yeah,
give me
he's
a break.
Everywhere. HLN, right? At
HLN
Dr. Drew.
Stop. Remember, Hillary killed me on that job.
So is it over?
Yeah,
I just saw
over.
You.
Ended
other...
last week. Yeah.
So you
son
got...
of a bitch.
Wait. You got... But
we had stopped months before we
okay.
decided.
It has
to
nothing
stop
to do with Hillary. Remember okay. you told us that.
Yeah.
CT man.
Sorry man.
God damn it, Brian. CT. Dr. Drew, we can't thank you enough, man.
It's always
Dr.
great
Drew,
to see you
best.
Guys. Been too long.
This is the final kid and the doc. We're out.